Good morning, Professor CNR Rao, Professor Ramamurthy, Professor Narasimha, our distinguished participants, speakers, invitees, and ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to welcome all of you this morning to this one-day discussion session on the tsunami. Tsunami is no longer an unfamiliar word, as it was for many a few months back. December 26, 2004, brought to us a revelation, its exact meaning manifested in several dimensions. A phenomenon which is very rare in the Indian Ocean region. December 26th event sent us a reminder that this region is not also immune to one such natural calamity. Showing 8.9 on the Richter scale, a massive submarine earthquake at 6:28 a.m. IST near the Sumatran island of Indonesia, triggered in the last part of the globe a massive disturbance in the ocean. This affected several regions, particularly in the Indonesia, in the Indian Ocean area. 86,000 people, affecting 11 countries, extending from the eastern part of the world, Indonesia and beyond, to Thailand, to Malaysia, to the eastern coast of India, going into the western coast, Sri Lanka, and of course the now downrange islands, and reaching as far as the Somali coast. India itself has been affected in a massive way. The total population that has been affected is 2.7 million. 10,000 were killed. 650,000 were displaced. So these statistics speak for itself, the massive scale in which the tsunami affected this region. Several discussions took place immediately following this, obviously, not only to understand what went wrong, what happened, what went wrong, and what is to be done. There were discussions in the Indian National Science Academy. There were DST-sponsored meetings, all to address the questions which are related to the scientific genesis of this entire thing, the implications, the physics, the geosciences, and also the type of observations that we need to make to provide a meaningful prediction, warning, and the type of preemptive steps that one could take. So there have been discussions on this front by several agencies and several groups in this country through discussion sessions, workshops, brainstorming sessions and whatnot, and we also brought some of the experts in this area from outside. So when Professor Narasimha agreed to organize a meeting of this kind, and that too at NIAS, it was quite obvious that we don't want to repeat exactly what has gone in the last few months in understanding this phenomenon and what to do with it and what kind of observational systems India needs or the region needs. So that has all been done in some form. So taking the cue from that, Professor Narasimha felt that we could bring in, keeping the interdisciplinary character of this institute, we try to bring in people who have been associated with this and also who are very familiar with the science and physics of it. We bring them together along with the people who are involved in the rescue operations and the other dimensions of tsunami. Tsunami which is related to the type of animal behavior that were reported, the problems related to understanding this particular phenomenon in the context of common man, the coastal processes, and ultimately, of course, the questions of actual field relief operations that were conducted by people and the psychology of the people who have been affected, the fishermen and many others in the coastal domain. So the whole idea of this meeting, Professor Narasimha thought, is to put together a set of specialists who have been directly associated with this area and also who have been a participant to the activities of the most recent tsunami, and to bring them together, exchange their own experiences, share their own experiences and exchange the views. So I'm sure you're going to hear more about it from Professor Narasimha himself. My pleasant task is to welcome all of you. And first of all, I would like to thank Professor C.N.R. Rao, who agreed to come today. In fact, he has got another one immediately following this, but still he kindly agreed to come and be with us this morning. Professor C.N.R. Rao's presence in a way is two reasons to me it is very important. He is, of course, currently the chairman of the advisory committee, the cabinet committee for science and technology to the Prime Minister. And of course, one of the outstanding scientists in this country. And he is visiting the NIAS for the first time after he has been recognized by the world, the Dan David Prize, which he won recently, instituted by the Israelis and considered as very close to that of Nobel Prize. So we are indeed very thankful, Professor Rao, to be with us today morning and grace this function. And also the other reason which I want to tell you is that whereas all of us discussed the post-tsunami scenario and participated in the relief, I think he was right amidst the tsunami when he visited Sri Lanka and got caught that morning when he was taking a walk, and I'm sure that he's going to share that very exciting experience with all of us in the context of his visit to Sri Lanka, and afterwards he came back. So we are going to hear that too. And we would like to congratulate you, Professor C.N.R. Rao, again for this very important recognition that you won based on your lifelong contributions to the cause of science, and particularly areas like solid state structural chemistry, nanoscience and technology, and so on. Professor Ramamurthy has come and he has agreed to be with us. He has been one of the very key figures in the post-tsunami period to discuss the strategies of dealing with this in the future, understanding the basis of this, and also organizing brainstorming session, which has led to identification of the type of configuration that we need to monitor the system. And we are going to hear a little bit on that. And I would like to thank Professor Ramamurthy for being with us today morning. My special thanks to Professor Narasimha, because he is really the key person who organized this, who has organized this particular meet. And he, with his own very broad understanding, not only the fluid dynamics and all the rest of it, has been able to conceptualize the type of content and the scope of this kind of a meeting at NIAS. And the very type of participants that we have today morning is an ample reflection of the way he has conceptualized this program. And we are going to hear from him. And he was ably assisted also by Dr. Sangeeta Menon of NIAS in this work. And I'm also happy to see Professor Vinod Gaur, another very important person who helped us to, again, formulate what should be the scope of this. He really advised us what not to do in this particular meeting, and also what has been left, which needs a little more discussion. So we are happy that Professor Vinod Gaur is with us, and I'm sure that we will hear a very authoritative account of the entire phenomenon of tsunami, with particular reference to the December 26th event. I do see, of course, many others. Professor Ramchandran is here, Professor Meenakshi Sundaram, and many others from the various areas, Professor Shetye and Professor Baldev Raj, and also my own erstwhile colleagues like Professor Mr. Sisir Das and others who have graced this occasion today to participate in these deliberations. And I have also Mr. V.V. Bhatt, the then Chief Secretary of the Andaman Nicobar, who participated, who was a very key figure on the relief operations at that island when the problems were at their peak. So I would like to, and there are many others, I'm not able to say all of them by name, but I would like to welcome all of you. We do look forward to a very, very intense deliberations for each of the presentation and many other aspects. And I'm sure that it's going to be not only an informative and educative thing, but also a very enjoyable day discussing something which is very serious, but at the same time has several dimensions, which makes itself amenable to a multidisciplinary approach of understanding the whole phenomenon. So let me welcome all of you once again, and can I invite Professor Narasimha to make his introductory remark before we start off the inaugural session. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Dr. Kasturangam. Let me add my word of welcome, first of all, to Professor Siena Rao and Dr. Ravi S. Ramurthy, and to all of you here for joining us in the in this meeting. We've called this meeting 6 months after the tsunami, and one of the objectives here is to take a look at where we are after the terrible disaster struck both the east and southwest coast of India on the 26th of December last year. It was a terrifying natural disaster, and according to the best estimates that I've seen, 11,000 or more lives were lost, and I don't know exactly how much damage to property has been caused. Unfortunately, our country is used to natural disasters. And if we go back and look at even over the what's happened during the last 5 or 10 years, almost every year there is some major disaster due to some reason or the other in the country. 2002, 2004, we've had serious monsoon failures. In 2001, there was a terrible earthquake in Bhuj. 20,000 lives were lost, and something like 50,000 crores worth of damage to property took place. In 1999, there was a terrible super cyclone in Orissa. Once again, nearly 9,000 lives lost, and several thousand crores worth of damage to property. Early this year in January, the Prime Minister said at the Science Congress, "We need better understanding of natural phenomena that lead us to such big natural disasters." Now, although we've had these major disasters that the country has had to tackle for many years, the tsunami last December, I think, was particularly traumatic for two or three reasons. In the first place, it was totally unexpected. Perhaps quite not entirely with reason. And I expect that we will hear about it later during this meeting. But the fact of the matter was that a tsunami was not something that the country had been prepared to encounter at all. I think the effect on the country of this disaster was particularly severe, partly because the disaster combined the suddenness and the unpredictability of an earthquake with damage that was very extensive, that occurred across, you can say, subcontinental scales, because the areas that were subject to destruction went all the way geographically from Indonesia to the southwest coast of India, to the east coast and the southwest coast of India. So in terms of the reach of the phenomenon that occurred in December, it's on the one hand the scale of a drought, on the other hand, it's the suddenness of an earthquake. Unfortunately, parts of our scientific understanding of this phenomenon are still poor, and predictability is a major scientific problem. Partly because it's related to earthquakes, and they remain a major problem, and I'm sure Professor Gaur and others here will talk about it. It so happens that the fluid dynamics of the tsunami itself, during most of its propagation, is not very difficult. It's easily understood, because in spite of all the havoc that it creates, it's really a shallow water wave. But the last stages, when it comes near the beach, still remain a very serious problem, something which really is not fundamentally understood. This, of course, does not mean that nothing can be done. And that, I think, is one of the main messages that should emerge from this meeting in this view. Although there are fundamental scientific problems associated with predicting such disasters, it is still possible, I think, to do a great deal about mitigating their effects, and to the best we can in trying to predict them. It's partly because of this that this institute has run courses on natural disaster management for many years now. So every year for the last 5 years, a batch of IAS officers have come here to this institute for a short course, for a week-long course on on natural disasters. And once again, in each of these courses, we have emphasized both the scientific and technological aspects of these disasters, and all the administrative and other measures that are required to be able to manage its consequences. The major questions for the country, as I see it, are we doing the best we can in terms of understanding these phenomena and the limitations to our understanding to it from the science and technology point of view? Given that fundamental problems may remain, are we doing the best we can to mitigate the consequences of these natural disasters? How can we improve matters in terms of for not only science and technology, but in terms of administration, management, and using the vast number of people in this country who actually are willing to spend time and money to fight the consequences of these disasters? And to answer these questions and to take a look at what the current position is and how it might most favorably develop in the interest of the country, we've been fortunate to assemble here the best minds that we have here from many different sectors. As Dr. Kasturangan mentioned, it's been an act of faith in this institute that some of these problems can only be tackled if we can get people from widely different backgrounds to take a look at them. And therefore, we are very fortunate that we have leading scientists who have devoted their lives to studying these problems, many administrators who had the task of handling these issues, and in many ways, the handling of the consequences of the recent tsunami disaster by the country has won praise everywhere. But we know that many things need to be done. There are all the numerous NGOs, the volunteers who did such a remarkable job of providing assistance at very short notice. And the policy makers who can help make things different when disaster strikes again. I mean, we can't say that disaster will not strike us again, so it's wise to be prepared to handle those consequences. So I'm very happy that all of you from all these different sectors, the scientists, the administrators, the NGOs, the volunteers, and all the other interested people are here this morning to join us at this meeting. You've all seen the program, so I won't go through it in detail. I see that we're also running a little bit behind schedule, so I will conclude by saying that we are looking at an overview of what's happened by Professor Gao. We will also look at a variety of other scientific approaches in terms of sensing, modeling, and so on in a second session. Professor Shetter is going to describe to us tsunamis in myth and history. And then we look at earthquake monitoring from Mr. Dattatreyam from IMED. In another session, we will have accounts by people who are actually there and saw what was happening. And Dr. Sukuma from CES here in the Indian Institute of Science will look at animal behavior in response to tsunami. And we conclude with a panel discussion which will be chaired by Dr. Arkat Ramachandran. So I think we have tried to look at all different facets of the issue. There will always be some which we will have missed, and we will try and see if we can fill it up during the time for discussion. I add my word of welcome to Professor C.N.R. Rao and Dr. V.S. Ramamurthy to this meeting. And before I request Professor Rao, I just want to say, in addition to what Dr. Kasturangan has already said, and without repeating it, that Professor Rao is here in many different capacities. First of all, as a concerned scientist, and secondly, as chairman of the Scientific Advisory Council to the PUYM, which has recently discussed a major new initiative in earth sciences and made certain proposals about how this might be done. As a scientist who was actually there, probably the only scientist who was actually there when this disaster struck, so he can describe to us, he was an eyewitness, and as we know, he was miraculously saved, and as a friend of this institute and its programs. Professor Ramamurthy, as Secretary DST, has been in the forefront of government's efforts to utilize the best that science and technology can provide to predict and mitigate the consequences of these disasters. And I welcome all the other distinguished persons who have joined us here today for this important meeting. May I now request Professor Rao to inaugurate the meeting.
Dr. Kasturirangan, Dr. Narasimha, Dr. Ramurthy, and friends. Very rarely I talk on issues I know nothing about, and this is one of those occasions. As a scientist, I avoid going to functions where I'm supposed to inaugurate and in a symposium or conference on a subject where I absolutely have no knowledge. But the only difference in this is that I've witnessed what it is. I cannot say I understand the science of tsunami. I know nothing about it. I know very little about atmospheric sciences or earthquakes. But I have common sense like most people have, I guess. Some common sense. And so whatever I'm going to say should be viewed in that manner. The other day I told my granddaughter that I'm just going to Israel with my wife. The first thing she asked me is there going to be tsunami there? And a month ago I said that we are going to the United States. Will there be tsunami in the United States? But anywhere you go, the first question is, will there be a tsunami? The effect of tsunami is unbelievable in human experience. An administrator may not understand that. A person who has just witnessed it probably understands that. An ordinary citizen. I was in Sri Lanka when the tsunami hit. I didn't know it was going to hit it at that time, just after breakfast in my hotel. At that time, I had a very, very distinguished friend of mine from Stuttgart, who was in the next hotel. Say, I understand the science of tsunami. I know nothing about it. I know very little about atmospheric sciences or earthquakes. But I have common sense like most people have, I guess. Some common sense. And so whatever I'm going to say should be viewed in that manner. The other day, I told my granddaughter that I'm just going to Israel with my wife. The first thing she asked me is there going to be tsunami there? And a month ago I said that we are going to the United States. Will there be tsunami in the United States? So anywhere you go, the first question is, will there be a tsunami? The effect of tsunami is unbelievable in human experience. An administrator may not understand that. A person who has just witnessed it probably understands that. An ordinary citizen. I was in Sri Lanka when the tsunami hit. I didn't know it was going to hit it at that time, just after breakfast in my hotel. At that time, I had a very, very distinguished friend of mine from Stuttgart, who was in the next hotel. Very, very distinguished. He comes to Bangalore quite often. He's a very well-known man. He's the director of the Max Planck Institute in Stuttgart, Max Planck Institute for First Row Perforce Show. Outstanding man. He was there. And I just met him last week in a conference where we both gave talks. In fact, I inaugurated the conference and gave a talk in my subject. He also gave a talk. He's still completely stupefied. He's still not out of it 6 months later. I want you to know that. He gets up, he says, quite often from sleep, thinking that he's in the middle of the ocean and he's unable to come out of there. And the reason was, that morning after breakfast, my wife, always, you know, she's always much wiser than myself. She said, let us not go near a beach. Let us go far away towards the river. But there is a river there. So we went towards the river, Bentota River. You know, that is one of the worst hit. I don't know if you have seen that. Bentota River banks are very badly hit. I think our administrator, somebody here should know about that. And we somehow went away from the beach. And this friend of mine said he's going snorkeling in the ocean. He went, took a boat, went to the middle of the ocean, Professor Martin Janssen from Stuttgart. And when he was snorkeling, the thing came. And he was there 1 kilometer away from the beach. And his boat was washed off. And he had to swim back. He says, I don't know how I had the energy or ability to swim 1 kilometer at that time. I don't know, I wouldn't have been able to. I'm a reasonable swimmer, but I won't be able to swim when something like that happens. And he did. He says that is a nightmare for him. He says it will take a long time to get out of that. So the human experience has been tremendous. For me, the experience was unbelievable because I was in the river in a boat with my daughter, granddaughter, our entire family. The entire family would have been wiped out except my grandson, who was in Bangalore. He always says that, if something had happened to you, I would have been alone in this world. Every time he says that. when we were in the ocean river, suddenly the river level went up by meters, not a few feet. It's difficult to imagine if you're in a boat. Suddenly the boatman said, I'm not going to do anything. He just took the boat to the river bank and he ran away. He just irresponsible, he may say, but he got scared. He said, sir, that the big boat, you know, in she, he was speaking, she, what is it, she, Sinhalese. I didn't know, understand what he was saying. I can't stay. And he just ran away and he left us there. So somehow I had to come away from there. What was amazing, within 3 minutes, you know, we started seeing lots of these crocodiles. You know, people will say, it's all in cinema and all that. No. My granddaughter said, what is that huge thing coming here? You know, there are lots of crocodiles that were being washed off. It was a very frightening sight, actually. Anyway, we eventually came back to the hotel with a terrible experience. I will not describe all that. You read that. All I can say is the waves that even I have seen, because I didn't see the first wave, the second one, second, third, fourth, fifth, even afternoon, 3 o'clock, it's still coming, you know, waves 1 meter high, were still coming, don't forget. They keep on coming and going back. When the first one hit in our hotel and all, I don't think any television program has caught the waves the way we have seen it. The only one television, BBC, I followed it the next few days in Bangalore, everything that came on TV. Only one picture somewhere near a hotel, it came up to the first floor and so on. That seemed to be most realistic of the waves we have seen. Unbelievable. There was no, in fact, my neighbor was another German friend of mine. He and his wife went to the ocean, and the wave when they came, he pushed him all the way, you know, his body, you know, being pushed against the huge brick wall or something, he was completely damaged, he went away to the hospital. In fact, he was interviewed on BBC. But his wife, of course, washed off, she died. Many people who slept in the ground floor of our hotel, on a bed, cot, everything in a room, the entire thing was took, the ocean took away the entire, all the contents of the ground floor rooms. There's not a single refrigerator or anything left in the room. You can't imagine that. And this dead again, another friend of mine, an Indian. Well, they're not Indian, they're all now French. An Indian lady from Tamil Nadu, whom I know, and they're French now, they live in France. And they and the next neighbor who were there, somehow they had come out, but the wife of that friend of mine, not a friend, somebody whom I knew, didn't come. She was not feeling well. She was sleeping. We never saw her again. That was the end of it. She had been washed off with the cot. So the power of the wave is something people do not understand. Whenever you plan, whatever you discuss, you remember that it is not an easy thing. It is not something you can plan so easily. So second, not only the power and the devastation it can cause in 1 minute. That is not mentioned either by Kasturangan or Narasimham. I don't know why they didn't mention that. In human history, it is the worst devastation that has ever occurred. I wanted to know that. Kofi Annan, I'm quoting him. Within an hour or something, 300,000 people roughly have been killed. No atom bomb has caused it. People talk about atom bombs. I'm a member of Atomic Energy Commission. I shouldn't be talking about it at all, mentioning an atom bomb. But I can tell you, no atom bomb can cause this. That is what you have to realize. And that took place in a very, very short time. And the effects are, the first thing I want to tell you is about communication. This entire thing is the communication. Any disaster management you are going to talk about, the communication is the first thing you have to discuss. Science, of course, you analyze and all this. You have a lot of time to discuss science of tsunami. There's no hurry about that. Communication is not something you have to do right away. How do you do that? The first thing that happened was no telephone worked in that area. Don't forget. Our hotel couldn't contact Sri Lanka, you know, just about 80 kilometers or 90 kilometers. Colombo could not be contacted. That is the point. And I was completely, you know, I strongly advise, and you know, I don't use this mobile and all that. For some reason, I had taken that day. That is the only time that mobile came. Once I just could contact Bangalore, I don't know how. I could contact my grandson was there in my house. That Christmas day, it was a holiday. That was the only call that I could make that day. I mean, otherwise, the entire telephone system was out. There was no way for several hours. Even till evening 5, there was no telephone possible. This happened at morning 9:30 or something. And till evening, there was no telephone connection. So I want to remember that. The rapidity with which things happen, the speed rather, you know, 1 hour, you can say it came to Andaman, 1.5 hours. Why didn't they inform Chennai? It's not so easy. That's the point. It's not so easy. You can have all your electronics, I'm a scientist, I do a lot of instrumentation, you come to my lab, I know all that. There's something called human being, behavior humans, that to Indian humans, don't forget India. We are different. We sleep, we take things easy, we are more relaxing type, you know. It's not easy for Indians to be mobilized in 1 minute, they have taken to a safe place, and are not so easy. Please think about that. Any disaster management have to look into the society we are living in. I'm reminded of Rajiv Gandhi's famous meeting about atomic energy. None of you was there. M.R. Srinivasan was then the chairman. Srinivasan was asked to present how we will handle a nuclear disaster in India. It was a very interesting meeting. Whatever we said, Rajiv Gandhi's thing is, you know, don't forget, when that happens, you will make them go to the bus stand, the bus will be there, bus will take you there. When who you meet them, people will run helter-skelter. They will not wait for your bus and direction and all. How will you manage? He always used to ask that. There is a point in that. That was very clear. Human behavior is very interesting when this happens. So you have to take that into account in any disaster management you are going to discuss here. Not going to organize. It is not easily available in the purview of an IAS officer. That's all I can say. Because he needs imagination. It is not an easy, simple administration. It is not a simple thing. Because humans behave differently when something like that happens. One thing, they all behaved extremely mature fashion. Nobody was shouting. That was the amazing thing. You would expect when that happened, people would be shouting, hitting, you know, pushing each other. No. They all behaved extremely well. Nobody pushed anybody around. Everybody was in distress. This is very interesting for me. That was wonderful about India. They are very well behaved. And then a train was coming, don't forget, in Sri Lanka. Next thing you know, nobody knew where the train was. The train had been washed off. So you must think of things like moving trains, sleeping families when disasters hit. Warning systems of that kind, which will somehow wake up all the people. Not easy. So I just am mentioning that. So we have to remember the society we live in, the conditions under which we live. All the power on earth, all the education I have, all my research didn't matter because I couldn't use my phone, contact anybody. That's all. Nobody was prepared. Nobody knew what to do. Nobody knew. The only good idea we had was somehow we must go from that spot to Colombo. That is the only idea all of us got. Somehow we should reach Colombo. That we knew. And how to get a bus. Very difficult. You know, I had my own car. I had a Toyota, brand new Toyota. But we didn't know where that car was, where the driver was. It's all gone. And that's all. So somehow we got hold of a bus. That was the greatest thing that happened in our life. And how to reach the bus was another problem. You have to walk through all the water with my little granddaughter and all. It's a very practical problem, you know, very practical problem. So any administrative thing that because there is one session on administration of this kind of thing, you have to do it realistic, very tough. Because it happens in, you know, at what, 700-800 miles an hour or something like that, the thing moves. It is much too fast for human reaction, even in the United States. And one thing I can say, if there is going to be legislation, the kind of legislation that will help is, nobody should live within so many meters of the beach. That would help. Because anyone who was half a kilometer to three-fourths of a kilometer away from the ocean was not affected. Not much. Well, I'm sure our Kalpakkam director will tell you, they were so lucky it was a holiday when that happened in Kalpakkam. Our schools are right 50 meters from the beach in Kalpakkam, in our atomic station there. It would have been a disaster if it were a working day. All the children would be there in the school. So it's a question of how close you are. How will you allow buildings, public buildings, schools in 50 meters from the beach? Should you allow that? You would have to think about such things. I think we should not build such things if it's a tsunami area or whatever area it is, much too close to the beach. Should hotels be built so close to the beach? Our hotel was just 100 meters from the beach, 120 meters. I think one has to look into legislations of that kind. Not because of the tsunami. I don't think hotels should ruin beaches coming so close anyway, even if there is no tsunami. But I think these five-star hotels take over the beach. In fact, they're right there. They have destroyed all the wonderful beaches of South India. I don't know whether all of you go to, we go a lot to beaches, in my wife and I and our family. Everywhere it has been destroyed. The worst, of course, is go to our Cape Comorin. You see, there's no Cape at all in Cape Comorin. Therefore, something I'm trying to tell you is that whatever I have experienced is one where human reaction is something very unusual. As somebody said, when these waves were coming, I was thinking of, you know, I know a little bit of Sanskrit, like Narasimha, and some of you know. I was thinking of it like a Pralaya scenario. So all religions feel when the end of the world comes, the water comes and floods and takes over the world. Water takes over. That is the feeling we, most of us got. And there was no helplessness of a different kind, not the usual kind of helplessness that we find face in a city. It is an extraordinary disaster, according to me, that I think one should not forget that. It has never happened before in mankind. Mankind has never faced this kind of disaster. That of a proportion where so many 100,000 people died. Second, the power of these oceans or the waves are such that no human can face that if it, once it comes. Once it hits. Therefore, whatever precaution you take should be before it comes, not after it hits. And second, legislation required to see where construction is there. And then, whatever relief you talk about, which you're going to talk about, please remember, I think it should look at, think about communication systems which are foolproof in some way. How somewhere it was, you know, you must have, you know, entire areas will be cut off for well, not hours, maybe days. How will you reach those places? Because we are very good, at least in India. Sri Lanka and all had much more difficult time. I wouldn't say backwards, certainly they're not as well prepared as India, definitely. I think we have a lot to think about that. I don't want to say much more, except that I'm glad you're discussing this. Coming back to the science part of it, though I do not do work in this area, I'm convinced of one thing. A country like India, which is not prone to disaster, which is, however, likely to be a scenario for many more disasters in years, I wouldn't be surprised. We should have a better management system, better administrative system for managing our meteorology, for managing our earthquakes, managing our every other thing related to this earth. I think it is high time we do that. And what Dr. Narasimha referred to is something like that. What we are proposing, Dr. Narasimha has played a big role, is suggesting some sort of a earth commission which combines all these facts, various factors that affect us in some way and create a new structure for that, see how to manage that. In fact, what is amazing is even in meteorology and areas, there are many reports. Two of the people who wrote those reports are, I think Dr. Ramchandran knows a lot about this, and Kasturirangan again wrote a report, but nothing. I think our system continues to be roughly whatever it was. I think the time has come for us to look about our weather, various disaster monitoring systems, and various kinds of things where administrative structuring, restructuring may be required. A lot of restructuring of existing departments. I think that aspect, I do not know, is going to be looked at by you. I think you have to look at that, how it's going to be administered. Don't forget, we have been witnesses in the last 1 or 2 years of major problems India has faced. The news has never reached this person, that the most important person concerned in Delhi. That itself has taken several hours. You know, even going to the wrong address, it was in the paper, I don't know if it's true, went to the wrong minister or something like that. That I don't know. All I know is the so-called crisis managing committee sitting in Delhi, whatever they do, when do they get the right message at the right time, and who informs them, and I don't know how that's going to handle it. These are all important, and one has to look into it. More than that, the scientific aspect of it, I think we have to reorganize it. I hope you are going to look at how science is going to be managed in this area. So thank you for asking me. I do not want to take more time. All I can say is it has been an experience in my life which I will not forget. It's a second birth, as somebody said. If you had one mistake, just walk towards the beach, I think all of us would have been wiped out. Just one simple decision saved my family. Maybe I would have lived, I don't know, about my wife, my child, grandson's daughter. So having experienced that, it was really a life and death situation that day. So it's a very great experience in a way. But I think people should remember that an experience is not something that you want again and again. So thank you so much.
Dr. Kasturirangan, Dr. Narasimha, Professor Rao, friends. He said, whenever there is a natural disaster in India, IMD is in the middle of it. For good reasons or bad reasons. But for reasons all the same. And this time also, when the tsunami hit the coastline here, IMD was in the middle of it. And we went through a series of experiences, which I think is extremely important to know and to respond, because there are a lot of lessons to be learned. In fact, much more lessons I learned during these few weeks following the tsunami regarding natural disasters than what I have ever learned in my entire lifetime. There are a few things which stand out in my memory, which I will never forget. Maybe about 2 weeks from the tsunami time, which I am going to first share with you. Next slide. Just to recollect, it was the 26th December 2004, 6:29 in the morning, Indian time, and the event took place very close to Sumatra, and the magnitude now we know was 9.3, the moment magnitude, but anything above 8. Everybody, there was no doubt it is a major earthquake, but the numbers, depending on which scale, from where you measure at all, a large number of numbers were quoted, but that's not important. It was definitely a major event, and you can also see where it was. At that time, I was watching the television, and suddenly I found it was the Tamil channel, though I was in Delhi. And suddenly the newsreader stood up and said, oh, everything is shaking, and just he ran away. And we could see it on the transmission. So immediately I called the central receiving station in Lodi Road. I said, hey, it seems to be something, some major event in the south. Have you noticed it? And they told me, yes, we have already had triggers from the stations in south. We are trying to download the waveforms, and they will let you know what is the event and where it took place in the next few minutes. Next slide. And a series of events which emerged during the next 4 hours, just to get the time scales right, the earthquake occurred. Immediately, the Indonesian coast had a major impact of the earthquake itself. The first tsunami casualty, as we now know, is the Andamans in about 45 minutes. But of course, there was an aftershock immediately after that, and therefore very few people knew that it was a tsunami which was creating problems. But there was a problem, and a lot of people were killed, but nobody knew even what was the extent of damage, except there was a major earthquake and probably some unusual tidal activities. After about 1.5 hours, Sri Lanka was struck, and we heard Professor Rao describing his first-hand account of what happened. And after about 2.5 hours, the Thailand coast was struck, and almost also the east coast of India was struck. The interesting thing is, in about 15 minutes, the central receiving station told me, yes, there was a major earthquake, but it is 800 kilometers away from the borders of India, closer to Indonesia. And normally it is just an event, and no further action is warranted. So it gets into the normal research mode. So we also did not do anything further on that. It was left at that. Since it is 800 kilometers away, it's not a matter of concern for us, even though it was felt in the southern India. Then only when the reports of unusual tidal activities and the deaths came in, somewhere around between 8 and 9, the word tsunami appeared in our minds. And at 9 o'clock, IMD informed the Central Management Authority, Disaster Management Authority, that the possibility of a tsunami cannot be ruled out. But that is already over. Event is already over. Many people will say, you people, you are all seasoned scientists. How come you didn't even think of tsunami? Well, frankly, we didn't think of tsunami at that time. And this question was asked several times afterwards in several quarters, including, for example, some people were asking, Andamans was hit after 45 minutes. Why didn't they tell Chennai that to be on the alert? I asked some other Navy people who live in the waters that why didn't they think of that? And they said, number one, there was a major earthquake at that time. This aftershock I'm talking of. And we have not seen a tsunami for the last 100 years. So she said, certainly we thought this is an earthquake event. And it was not considered important to convey to Chennai what is happening, because they don't see a link between Andaman Nicobar and Chennai. Of course, the other point which Professor Rao pointed out also, that at that time, there is no communication and you are worried about what next second, and not who are the possible victims of this after 2 hours. So obviously, even people who are living with water every day were not thinking of tsunami, leave alone a scientist living in a place where there is no water even in the tap. So a question that doesn't arise. But at the same time, there is also a message here. We had 2.5 hours. If only the Nagapattinam church had been told evacuate, run, they would have run. We could have said 2,000 people. If only the message has gone on to the Madras beach, large number of people wouldn't be playing basketball there. They would have gone home. So we had 2.5 hours, but we were not prepared. So when the tsunami waters receded, one message was very clear. We were not prepared for a tsunami. This was the first lesson which we learned. Next slide. Just to get the magnitude of this, that you see where is Indonesia and what all are the places which were actually hit hard. It goes right up to east coast of Africa, Somalia, Kenya, Tanzania, a whole range of places. And I read somewhere the wave went thrice across the globe. Not 1 meter wave, but that suddenly the wave traveled thrice across the globe. That was the magnitude of this earthquake. Next one. Many people ask me, oh, you people were not prepared for it. You should have joined the Pacific warning system. Everything would have been solved, even at the highest level. I wanted to read this. This is the tsunami bulletin number 1, which the Pacific Tsunami Warning Center issued within 10 minutes after the event from their earthquake thing. It says this bulletin is for all areas of the Pacific Basin, except Alaska, British Columbia, Washington, which will be done by another center. It's not important. But read the bulletin. This message is for information only. There is no tsunami warning or watch in effect. An earthquake has occurred with these preliminary parameters: origin time, coordinates, location, magnitude 8. Evaluation. This earthquake is located outside the Pacific. No destructive tsunami threat exists based on historical earthquake and tsunami data. This will be the only bulletin issued for this event unless additional information becomes available. The West Coast of Alaska, etc. will issue bulletin for the rest of the area. This is the bulletin which came from the Pacific Tsunami Warning System. So if somebody tells you, or if you have read somewhere, that we should have joined the Pacific Tsunami Warning System, everything would have been in order and no damage would have taken place, please don't believe a bit of that. Because if you want to know whether there was a tsunami in this part of the world, you must have tsunami warning system in this part of the world. Indonesia was a member, and no system would have saved them, because right there at that place they were there. There is nothing called the warning system which will work for 15 minutes. So we have to address our problem from our perspective, and there is no easy solution for this. Next. Okay. I just give you in perspective what IMD did. It's not important. It's not to justify anything. Just to let you know what happened. 6:29, between 6:29 and 7, the trigger occurred. And then they downloaded, and about around 7 o'clock they already told me that there was a major event in Indonesia. But as I told you, they also said to me, don't worry, because it's too far from us. Then telephone call received from parts of South India, because they felt the troubles, and a distant earthquake informed the concern no earthquake was located within the southern parts of the land mass. So no alert. Then 8 to 9 more data analyzed to confirm location, informed all concerned about the occurrence, till the information about the tsunami, actual tsunami hitting came. There was no indication of tsunami in IMD or any other place. Next one. Next one is not important. I will just indicate three more events. I will come back to this later, but I just want you to keep in mind, after the 26th December, there was of course an aftershock soon after, within half an hour or 1 hour. On December 31st, 2004, there was a false alarm. And there were even orders to evacuate. And my minister went, had to go on the air saying, no, no, this is not all bogus. There is no such thing, say 6 or 7 hours after the initial alarm. And many people say, what is this non-professional way of handling it? Then on 28th March 2005, another major earthquake in the vicinity of the earlier event without any tsunami was recorded. Now at that time, as soon as the earthquake was detected, the control center system was alerted. They issued the warning. After about 1 hour, we got additional information, like for example, the unusual activity in the Sumatra coast or the Thailand coast. There was no report. And then we said that there is no reason for tsunami alert now. They withdrew the alert. How it should have been done, how it can be done. So within 3 days, on 26, we had no clue what's happening. And confirmed that this is credibility is not high, that message also went and it should be withdrawn. But they felt that giving an issue and warning and withdrawing it after 3 days, 3 hours or 2 hours is a lack of professional competence. Not true. It's not true at all. But that's the way it was done. And because of this, DST organized a meeting on disaster warning communication, because I realized there is an extremely important component here which need to be addressed. I cannot resist the story which I keep saying in every quarters. There was a guy who was walking on the road and there was a person in front of him and there was a small snake behind him. So this fellow immediately shouted, snake, snake, snake. That person turned back, saw that and had a heart attack and died. Unfortunately, it turned out the snake was just a piece of rope. So everybody came and then thrashed this guy. You idiot, you should have first checked whether it is a snake or a rope. Unnecessarily, you put a panic in him and he died. And what do you do? So this fellow said, yeah, that's a mistake I made. I should have checked this. Lo and behold, 15 days later, was walking on the road, another man in front, another snake in the behind. So immediately, he went closer to see whether it is a rope or a snake. The snake got agitated and bit him. And he died. So the villagers came and said, well, idiot, first you issue the warning, let him run away. How does it matter if there is a false alarm? You have no business to go and check when the issue is at stake is so important. So gave him a good thrashing. So he went back again. Bad luck, 15 days later, low again, and the same road again, another person in front and another snake at the back. Then this fellow remembered both the thrashings which he had earlier. Then he said, the best alternative seems to be, close your eyes and start praying that the snake goes in its own way, the man goes safe and it does, nothing happens. What happened, I do not know. But the fact remains, communicating in a time when there is an emergency is not easy. It depends what communication you will give and what response the other person will give. Both are important. Technology failure is incidental. It is the human response for communication. It becomes important. And in my assessment today, we are prepared technologically. We are not prepared human communication-wise. We need to address this, and I will come back to this later, a little later. 28 March, as I said, response was exactly right. Yep, warning was given. It was communicated to the public at large, and then the warning was withdrawn when the reasons for warning were not there at all. But importantly, unfortunately, our system is tuned for a cyclone, 2 days, 3 days warning. We have no system in place when it is 2 hours of warning. People may be traveling in train. People may be sleeping in their thing. People may be somewhere else. And what language you communicate, what medium you use, what should be the response? Should as soon as an alert comes, should everyone run away 1 kilometer from this? Even if there is a fire warning in a 5-star hotel, only 50% of the people get out of the bed and come to the lobby. The others continue to say, this is always, there is a false alarm, so you don't have to worry, let me take a chance. So this always happens all the time. So how to communicate? What to communicate, how to tell the people, how to respond to a communication, all this is an important issue which has not been addressed. But I the meteorological department comes back and says that anticipated wave heights is only about half a meter, so you don't have to worry. Withdraw the tsunami alert, everybody goes back to normal work. They are thankful for IMD to issuing a warning and thankful for withdrawing the warning, and nothing more happens. Canada, if you, there is a warning is issued, the withdrawal cannot be done by that organization. It has to have cabinet approval. So that means once you realize that there is no need for a warning, it takes several hours before the D-alert is issued in Canada. The police chief or anything, but don't stop. Today we are doing that. Public address systems, but all of them should be without human intervention. So we are trying to do that, but we are far from it at the moment. It is not only technology, but there is also psychology involved. So NIAS has an excellent opportunity to continue to work in these areas, because I think you always do when everything falls between stools. So you are the right person to do that. Next one. Okay, just to give you an idea, on December 26, this is a Colombo sea level monitor, tide gauge. You see here, when the tsunami, it goes out, next few hours it's non-functional, and then there is a lot of after, because the wave comes go several times, reflection, all sorts of physical phenomena control this, and generally they say in Pacific Ocean, which is much larger than ours, the fourth or fifth wave is the most damaging, whereas in this small area like ours, Bay of Bengal, is the second wave which is the most damaging. I think probably Professor Shetye will be elaborate a little more. I just heard it yesterday that there will be a series of waves, but not all of them with the same problem. Whereas on March 28, you see the wave where it has hit. Its amplitude is very small. And on 28th March, the D alert was given on the basis of this information, not from Colombo, but from Indonesia and from Thailand. We contacted those agencies there, and we asked for unusual tidal wave activity, and when there was no tidal wave activity there, we realized it is not going to be in India. So probably this is one way where you can actually detect a tsunami potential danger without even making new investment. Not adequate, but this one possibility. Next. Okay, now Nature on 9th June has said that the stat patterns indicate that the great earthquake was often followed by major triggered events in the vicinity, like the one on March 28, 2005. Now, considering the background, obviously this cannot be ruled out. Yes, stresses are building, stresses are likely to result in triggered earthquake, an earthquake is likely to give rise to a tsunami, tsunami is likely to hit our coast, but we don't know what magnitude, but the probability still exists. So we have to get prepared for this. We cannot say that 100 years you don't have to worry, after that we will worry. Next. Just to get an idea, tsunami generation, if you look at what are the various reasons, tsunami earthquake is not the only reason, but almost 75% of the tsunamis across the world are because of tectonic. There are a few others, volcanic, landslide, BTRs, and even unknown reasons, some fraction is there. But that means earthquake is a source of tsunami, and therefore any earthquake which is going to take place near the Indonesian Andaman, in that region under the sea, is a potential source of tsunami. Yeah. Next. This is the location of the main shock, and you can see our things. We have a huge fault line on the northern Himalayas. That is not tsunami, that's one of the earthquake itself is this. That's one of the reasons why 50% of this country is vulnerable for an earthquake disaster. But the one on the near Andaman going right up to Indonesia is a tsunami-genic zone. This is what we have to worry about. And on the west coast, again, you have a small tsunami-genic source close to the Oman coast. And we have the western coast is vulnerable to possible tsunamis also. Next. Same thing in more detail. It's not important. Next. Okay, in terms of world oceans, where we are, Pacific Ocean, of course, takes more than 60%. 58% of the tsunamis are in this. You have to look at the various other things. For example, our own is a very small fraction. It's a major is in Pacific. And you could also would have seen from the earlier one, Pacific area is maximum, and certainly there are a lot more sources for potential tsunamis. But our recent event has shown even that one event is adequate to compensate for the entire savings which you have done in the past. So clearly, it's a matter of concern for all of us. Next. unique circumstances, just to summarize, low probability and high consequence hazard with a long recurrence interval. Reason, the consequence of this is, if a Department of Science and Technology asks for a funding to put a tsunami warning system before 26 December, we would have been thrown out and probably I would have lost my job, has gone out of my mind. So fortunately, this one event says even low probability you have to be prepared, and before the public memory fades, we have to put the system in place. Despite large aftershocks in the Andaman region since Sumatra, there have not been any tsunami-genic events till date, but that's only 6 months, so there is not, it doesn't give you a lot of consolation. And great events of magnitude greater than 8 could result in triggered events according to recent studies, which is true, but also the March 28 says even if more than 8 need not cause tsunami. So there will be uncertainties arising out of this. We must therefore design a tailored tsunami warning system for the specific circumstances of the Indian Ocean. We cannot copy the Pacific system. Next one. And we also realize, unlike a cyclone, we have very limited time. The limited time is for Indonesia is 10 to 10, 15 minutes, Andaman 45 minutes, Thailand 90 minutes, Sri Lanka 90 minutes, India 150 minutes, and Maldives approximately. This is not the exact thing, but it is approximately. But what it says is, you are going to have 1.5 to 2 hours. This is all you have got, what best you can do. Next. Now, what are the components of a tsunami warning system? What we are seeing is, since bulk of the thing tsunami in this part of the world is caused by earthquake, we must have a 24/7 earthquake monitoring system. If you don't know earthquake has occurred in under the sea in that region, you have lost already 45 minutes. So we cannot afford to. So you must have an earthquake monitoring system. As Dattatreya will elaborate a little more detail, we do have an earthquake monitoring system with its 24/7 at the moment. We may strengthen it a little, but exists. We must have a tide gauge. As I mentioned there, look at the tide gauge in Colombo, Indonesia, Thailand. You already get information a tsunami has been formed. Then supplement it with the sea level data and the ocean bottom sensors for tsunami when it is available. See whether there are clear indication of a tsunami formation. If the tsunami is actually formed, you must confirm the warning. And that can take anywhere from 30 to 40 minutes. Right? And then once you confirm the warning, all the modeling inputs have to be put in, identify where are the potential areas, vulnerable areas, and you have to have a national emergency response plan, which could involve evacuation. Now, in India, evacuation is a very, very difficult thing because many people choose to stay back and risk their life rather than evacuate, because if they come back after 1 hour, nothing may be left in that house in a situation like that. So clearly, many places which we have seen, even for a cyclone alert, evacuation is not easy to implement. It's probably one of the most challenging jobs. Of course, you need infrastructure to evacuate, like transport and where to go and how to take care of their basic needs and things like that. But even otherwise, even psychologically, there is a problem. But if the situation warrants it, you have no alternative. We have the National Earthquake Monitoring Center. We are trying to put in the sea level data quickly. We are trying to put the ocean bottom system in about next 2 years. And when all the 3 days afterwards, we have the necessary ingredients for having an effective warning system in the country. Next. Okay, I will leave this to Dattatreya to discuss. Continue this. Yeah, next. 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 Okay, next. Next. Okay, next. Okay, this I've already discussed what we are thinking, and there will be sure more discussions on this. Next. Okay. I did mention about the disaster communication, the last mile problem, and we need to have an enormous effort to create public awareness on these issues. And if we don't do this, the disaster communication will continue to be a last mile problem. And when you have 2 hours of warning time, last mile problem can totally obliterate what all you have achieved in the earlier ones. And I believe the biggest challenge at the moment today is in this sector, which has not yet been addressed in totality. Next. Dissemination system, as I mentioned, we already have a cyclone warning dissemination system in operational. But this is through a chain of command. But that is not adequate, so we are now trying to go through the mobile telephones and also the landlines through a new initiative. And we are also having a telephone interactive voice response system. If there is an earthquake report, it should be possible for a person to ring up 1717 and get what is happening, what is the latest information on this, on any particular thing. So all the three we are attempting to do now, and our idea is that you will reach the person irrespective of language, irrespective of location, irrespective of the technology access which we have to him. We have to use multiple technologies and maybe even ham stations, the satellite-based radio stations and the cell phones and the normal cell phones, normal phones, all of them will play a part in this. Next. I did mention about the calibrated response. I don't think I will have to elaborate it any further. I've already conveyed what I had, because but the basic problem is a false alarm. If the public is not trained to accept a false alarm, as in the case of Japan, you will have a difficulty. And I recollect a few years before, there was a cyclone alert to a place in Orissa, and the cyclone decided to go in a different direction as compared to the track predictions by IMD. So there was no cyclone in that area where there was an alert given. And 1 week later, another cyclone alert was given, and the public said, well, these fellows are not reliable, so we don't take it seriously. The cyclone did hit that place and resulted in a major damage, both in terms of life and property. Now, clearly, the public have not been trained what it means, what a warning means, what is the necessity of taking a false warning. If the Pacific warning system had 90% false warning when they started, and even today it's about 50%. It has not changed very much. But the people have been trained how to take it, and they also accept it as a part of the entire management strategy. This we will have to do. So, but I will not say anything more at this stage. Thank you very much.
Join us for tea, but let me thank once again Professor Rao and Professor Ramurthy for giving these absorbing accounts, very informative accounts of the subject that we have today, namely about what we do in the 6 months after the disaster that struck the coast of India. So please join us for tea, and we will reconvene in another 10 minutes. Thank you once again for joining us.
On one side, that famous earthquakes in Maharashtra, which just could not be understood because of the fact that the stability of the Deccan Plate was never in question. He went into the bottom of the reasons for that, came out with micro faults, micro elements, and identified how these zones are again potentially vulnerable. Fourth earthquakes, and he had done considerable research in this area. Discovery of a thick high-velocity route of the Indian lithosphere beneath the Indian shield, and the determination of the velocity of the Indo-Eurasian plate convergence using GPS geodesy. In fact, I should say that he has been a pioneer in the use of GPS systems for geodetic applications. Because today he's going to speak on the issues related to the plate tectonics, the scientific basis for the tsunami, and also the type of things that we need to do in this country in the context of understanding these kind of phenomena. As I said, that his background is such that probably he's the only one in this country who can speak with that kind of an authority in areas where we deal with the plate tectonics, the movements, and the related issues that lead to the prediction for the earthquakes and then triggering off the subsequent events like tsunami. So may I request Professor Vinod Gaur to deliver his talk.
Template of what must have been the fate of many an Indian ocean shores in the first few hours of sunrise on that fateful day. The immediate cause of the giant waves that engulfed unwary communities on the Indian Ocean shores was a giant paddle at the bottom of the sea in this part of the Indian Ocean that uplifted vertically several kilometers, couple of kilometers of the water column by something like 20 feet. As the waters rose and the leveling action of gravity began, the interplay of inertia and the restorative gravity force set into motion these gravity waves, which will cross across the Indian Ocean into the Pacific and the Atlantic, and will keep resounding the world oceans for many days. That's a kind of a sketch showing us to what happens to these waves when they come near the shore. It has been mentioned before. They begin to feel the ground and get shortened in length as well as their periods change. And because of the necessity to pack all the energy that has to be conserved in the shortened space, they gain in height and end up in a flood of inundation. So we see that kind of a land which is uneven, and what would happen when something like this comes. Serendipitously, there were a few satellites in the sky at the time which could watch this unruffling of the Indian Ocean surface. JSON, NOAA satellites, and the French satellites, the Japanese satellites, and in retrospect, this picture was created. It shows the potential of what can be gleaned from space about the ocean waves, even though the waves as they travel from the source are not as much in height, typically of the order of only about 40, 50 centimeters, as you will see over here. They only gain in height when they reach the shore. So that's the kind of potential that does exist. And this is a picture, 7 hours after the tsunami. And you can see the enormity of the energy that must have been expended, which kept these waves rebounding and unruffling the world's oceans, even at the end of the second day. The tsunami waves and their close cousins, which are these waves that are an enchantment to witness on the ocean front, they share many things in common. And the main thing that they share in common is that as they begin to feel the ground underneath the rigid bottom, they shorten in their length, as I've already said. They decrease in velocity, and therefore they trip over their predecessors, whose velocities have been lessened because they have come to a shallower ground, and they steepen. This is called shoaling, and that's the reason for the inundation that we have. In other respects, of course, as to the particle motion and the wavelengths and time periods, they differ very greatly, simply because of the nature of the source created by them. These waves are created by the winds rippling the surface of the ocean as they skim over it, and therefore the energy is confined to a very shallow layer, whereas these waves involve the entire ocean in the dynamics of what is eventually going to advance on these unwary shores. This is a schematic to show as to what kind of energies are involved. This is the way a rupture could occur, the kind of rupture which would, for example, lift this piece of land or somewhere over here and cause the water column to rise. For reasons that I will explain a little later, imagine this piece of the Earth's crust which is sliding underneath another slightly lighter continental or island neighbor, simply because it's heavier and there's a fracture plane there and there are certain forces at work which are pulling it out. And this is the ductile zone, so there's a continuous slip in this ductile zone. But over here, friction locks these regions. The dotted line shows what will happen to the compressed part of this region after the attendant stresses have reached a certain limiting value, and then it will uncompress so that what was here would reach over here. And you can imagine that is going to raise this surface over here, the land surface, and this is the kind of an impulse that will be the generator of this tsunami. The amount of energy released will be some fraction of the total work done, which was involved in storing all that strain energy over here before it ruptured. And that can be shown on the basis of physical laws, that it's equal to the length, which is this length of the rupture, the width, which is the width that ruptures down dip, this amount of slip that takes place, which in the case of the Sumatra earthquake varied from about 5 to 20 meters, and the coefficient of rigidity. So those together give us the total amount of energy that is released in that rupture, a quantity which today can be determined with unprecedented accuracy from seismograms, and this is then converted into a more user-friendly number called the magnitude, which is related to this seismic moment by this empirical relationship. The empirical relationship makes sure that that number is converted into something which is close to the Richter magnitude with which we have been familiar for several decades. It is using that kind of a knowledge that one can compute that given a certain parameters of this rupture, for example, how long, how wide, and what was the slip, and making some assumptions about the rigidity of the crust, about which we have fairly good idea, one can compute the progression of a tsunami across the ocean. And here is a cartoon to show that, and it is based on some real world situations, that here is the epicenter, these are the Aleutian Islands, that is Hawaii, and when an earthquake takes place here, then its parameters are determined. That means that length, breadth, rupture, the slip of the rupture, determined within less than half an hour, and this whole thing is generated. So one can imagine that all the that input data one would need would be these parameters of this. One could, of course, also do the reverse of it. That is, given the tsunami data gauged by the tide gauges, for example, the tide gauges around the Indian Ocean, which were in place in 1861, in fact, they had been put just a few years earlier, were able to detect tides at these places, which were inverted to determine as to what were the rupture parameters of this 1881 earthquake that shook Nicobar. It had a magnitude of 7.9. It occurred at a time when seismic instruments were still unknown. And this is an example of how tide gauge data can be used to constrain that. This can only, of course, be used in retrospect, but it has an advantage that it provides an independent check on the rupture parameters that have been determined from the seismic source. More importantly, the effect of modeling such as this can be, or the possibility and capability of modeling tsunamis and their spread, as shown here, has a very important application, because one could, and seismologists have a means of doing this, estimate a whole ensemble of possible ruptures and their mechanisms in given zones and generate these tsunamis and then work out as to statistically what will be the hazard at any particular point that could be expected. And this could be converted into hazard maps in terms of the probabilities of exceedance of some intensities of the hazard at a given point x, y, z over the period t. And that is this hazard defined like that. The time has come when we don't talk of hazard in a qualitative manner, but we have to define this. And unless we have maps giving this probability, they are not of great use in planning either engineering structures or designing them. This is what we need as the dynamic parameter. These are the data inventories that would be needed, the shallow coastal bathymetry and shore topography, which of course we can determine by surveying. Bathymetry and landforms of the intervening ocean, the landforms will diffract energy, and that's very important, because even though a certain country or a certain shoreline may not be in the path of the tsunami, diffracted waves can cause tsunamis over there. But of course, the mapping, the modeling will take care of that. Seismic waves travel much faster than the tsunami waves, which already are jet set, but the seismic waves travel with velocities which are about 50 times more. And therefore, at about 18 seconds or so, I beg your pardon, 18 minutes or so, they will be felt around the world. Here, for example, is a rupture which causes seismic waves to propagate through the body of the Earth and reach virtually all points within about 18 minutes. That's the kind of a record. Even the first few seconds of the record is enough to give us a knowledge of where the epicenter is, what is the magnitude, and if we have several of these from different points on the Earth's surface, one can even determine as to what is the nature of a rupture, and thereby tell or be able to tell as to whether there's a possibility of tsunami or not. Because earthquakes themselves and the vibrations caused by them do not couple very strongly with the water. What couples with the water is when the water is physically raised. So unless there is that giant paddle at the bottom of the sea, a sudden rupture which uplifts the water level, a tsunami will not be generated. Often it so happens that there are fault ruptures, which move like this. That means horizontally, one part will slip against the other. What is happening in California and West Coast is a classic example of that. And they will not generate tsunami because the surface of the sea has not been greatly altered. That's the kind of seismogram, for example, which was detected. And you can see that this is the first P wave. It was detected at, what, about 18 minutes after the event in Indiana in the United States. And at the United States Geological Survey also, there were people who had already worked out as to what the rupture mechanisms are. And you can see that the tsunami itself travels much slower, so that, as Dr. Ramamurthy already said, that there's adequate time for warning. And this is 1 hour and so on and so forth. You will see that the tsunami is here also, although the source was much nearer to Phuket, for example. The tsunami reached there after about an hour. That's because it's a shallow sea, and the shallow sea retards the velocity of the waves. The velocity of the waves, for example, as they come to the shore, is reduced to about a tenth of their velocity on the ocean. So instead of 700 kilometers, it will become more like 70 kilometers. And that is why Phuket was disturbed only after about an hour or 45 minutes of the event. This is an example of the Bhuj earthquake, but this is the way how data from a number of stations around the globe can tell us as to what kind of a rupture has given rise to those ground motions. Okay, how do we visualize tsunami or ground motion caused by an anticipated earth rupture is something which we know. Professor Narasimha said that the fluid physics has been known for over a century. And if we know the topography, if we know the geometrical shape of the container, which in this case is the ocean, and the source, then that is not a very difficult task to determine as to how the tsunami will progress. And as I said before, that seismologists could then ask the question, what are the n possible ways in which a rupture could take place there, generate tsunamis for all those n cases, and find out what is the worst case, and depending on that, create a hazard map of the region. But the critical question is, how do we define its parameters? And for that, I'll dwell very briefly on the underlying causes of what moves those, what causes that rupture. The causes of that can be understood in the framework or the model of the thermodynamic engine of the Earth. It's a very unique planetary engine, unique, we believe, to planet Earth, that has been engineered by it for losing heat. We do not know if this kind of a mechanism operates on any other planet. And the way it does is to remove the heat from the interior through these convection currents, and these convection currents in turn, much like what happens in a textbook example of this material being heated and the lighter heated material rising up and breaking through this surface, which is the Earth's crust, and then after congealing, it will add to the Earth's crust and will broken again and move out. And that is how the ocean crust is formed. It's actually the surface cooling limb of the convecting cell, which has been formed at some place. And when it descends into the mantle, it closes that convection loop. And while it's descending, it grinds against whatever lighter materials, continental materials, materials which are products of several successive differentiations, chemical differentiations under gravity, which will make sure all this scum on which we live, for example, which is lighter, it stays over here, the heavier part of the ocean goes down, ocean floor. And this, of course, grinding over here will create volcanoes. But grinding in this region, in the brittle part, it creates that rupture. But the rupture has to be under the ocean in order to create a tsunami, because it has to vertically displace that column of the water. So if we have a good idea of the geography and the inventory of high resolution maps are in the front of the seismologist who is looking at where the rupture has taken place, then it should not be very difficult to make an estimate as to where the tsunami is going to be generated or not. That's another picture of it, and it shows, for example, how the ocean floor is being created here in the Atlantic Ocean between South America and Africa, how this material upwells over here. These two were together at some time, and all this is new ocean floor a part of the upwelled material, the cooling limb of the convection, which will eventually someday, when it cools over here and becomes even heavier, then it will break through this welded contact and go into the bowels of the earth. You can see this is a picture of the Atlantic Ocean when all the water has been drained, and you can see this fracture system very, very clearly indeed. When I was a student, we used to be told that the earthquakes are not found everywhere, but they describe some very narrow, long belts on the surface of the earth. And in the 1950s, we did not know as to what was the cause of it. One had, of course, realized, and this was based on certain observations following the 1906 California earthquake, that earthquakes are caused by fractures in the earth. So obviously, it was in everyone's mind that these are some kind of fracture systems that girdle the earth, but nothing more than that. Later on, of course, there were, that just shows how stresses, differential stresses will cause strains to build up till a fracture can take place, and these two parts will displace. And that is what an earthquake is. And of course, if the energy which is pumped into the system continues, then the strain will build up to the limit where it cannot bear any further strain. There will be a slip, then it will build up again, and there will be a slip, build up again, and this is the earthquake cycle. This line, although shows a little uncertainty, is known to a fairly good extent. It's known fairly well, and this is of the order of 1 in 10 to the 4. So that's the kind of ultimate failure strain level. If you take something like a 10 kilometer stretch of rock, 10,000 meters, and if we stretch it or extend it by 1 meter, then it's ready to go. One may not be able to tell exactly when it will, but that's about the time when it is ripe for failure. So if one knows as to what is the rate at which the strain is building up, and that can now be constrained by GPS geodesy and other methods, then one can tell as to what is the time that it will take from the last draining or resetting of the strain reservoir, how much time will it take before the next earthquake is due. These are the methods and these are the anticipations. Meanwhile, these fracture systems got identified with fracture systems which descend deep up to the ductile layer in the earth, which is about 150 kilometers from the surface, and dissect the earth's surface in a number of spherical caps, which are shown here at their boundaries. Because one can see that within these spherical caps, within these bodies, and they are called plates because they are thousands of kilometers in extent, but only 100 kilometers or so thick, in analogy with the plate. For example, here we see that there are very few earthquakes in between. There are very few earthquakes in between over here. And these are just reproduced there. And these we know now are the plate boundaries. That it is at the plate boundaries that the convective motion from underneath manifests itself by piling stresses wherever they join each other. And these stresses, of course, will vary, and that is why you see these directions, which tell you as to the direction in which this part of this plate is moving with respect to that, and with respect to this over here, it's opening up this chasm over here in which new material will come and become the next ocean floor. But over here, it is going underneath these lighter parts of the continental margin. So we now know that this is the paradigm, this is the model in which we should seek the answers as to where and when. This is another schematic to show the whole thing, how the ocean floor, having been created here, eventually as it spreads, it becomes colder and heavier and eventually descends into the Earth's mantle. And whilst descending, it creates these ruptures over here at the ocean continent boundary. And it is only the ocean continental boundary earthquakes, provided that the rupture lies underneath the water column, that are capable of generating tsunami. So I just want to take a couple of examples to show the cyclic nature of this, because there have been a lot of reservations expressed about the cyclic nature of earthquakes, and there's not a complete unanimity there, because many people argue that earthquakes are a piece of nonlinear phenomena. They are a piece of critical phenomena, and therefore it is not possible in theory to be able to forecast their future occurrence. However, having agreed that there are these boundaries which are going to be the main locus of earthquakes, the main places, the main regions where stresses are being piled up, we next ask as to what is the strain rate, if we answer that question, or what is the strain budget at a particular time, how close it is to 1 in 10 to the 4, then one can make a probabilistic hazard map of the region. As I said, I take, this is the California region over here, and this is a plate boundary, just to refresh your memory again over here. This is this part of the boundary over here. And there is one region over here where earthquakes have happened almost repetitively, like a clockwork precision. The last one was due in 2001, and in fact it didn't happen until October last year, which caused a lot of people to doubt the veracity of this kind of a process. But it is quite clear that if stresses are piling up in a certain region, then simply because the material has limited strength, they are bound to rupture at some time or the other. Here is another example, a very classic example of what happened in Japan. This is the Pacific Ocean. And in 1707, there was an earthquake here in 1703, I beg your pardon, in the Tokyo region. And 4 years later, this entire region broke. So that around by the end of 1707, and these broke by great earthquakes. Small earthquakes do not release much energy. But it's the great earthquakes which constitute most of the energy release. Just as if you take a plate and throw it on the floor, you can count the pieces that you have and their dimensions, and you can show that they follow a fractal law. The same happens with earthquakes also. And according to that, the largest energy will be contained in the greatest earthquake. So this was released, and you can see this over here. It was straining towards this point where it will break, and you can see that that level is about 10 to the minus 4. It's pretty well the same. Then there was a sudden slip. In 1854, a good 140 years later, that part broke on 23rd December. And as it broke, it piled up all these stresses at the edge of this. As happens in a crack, you know, all these stresses pile up at the crack edges. And a day later, this huge earthquake took place. Of course, it could have all taken place in one large leap, as happened over here. But such are the vagaries of nature that it happened in this particular way. And then in 1923, the famous Kanto earthquake, where a lot of damage was caused because of the fact that it happened around midday and housewives were cooking, and more damage was wrought by fire than by the earthquake itself. In 1944 and 46, this part ruptured, but that part has not ruptured. It is one of the two most heavily instrumented regions in the world where scientists believe they can catch an earthquake in the act. And this is called the Tokai region. It has been designated as a region of very high expectation of seismicity. And there are a large number of instrumentations here, strain meter, tilt meter, seismographs, all kinds of things, telemeter to the Japanese Meteorological Department, which looks after this, and they are directly connected to the Prime Minister, and they have a three-member team who always carry something in their pocket so that if they hear something unusual happening, an alert goes round, and they immediately have to come within half an hour or so and examine the situation. And that's the last region I'll talk about, is the Anatolia fault, and one can see how this fault has been zipping and unzipping, and that's the Izmit earthquake, which took place in 1999, and this part remains unbroken. That is the part, you know, which is about 40 kilometers south of Istanbul and is a matter of great concern. The world's geophysicists are concentrated in this region again to see as to what might happen. So knowing this much as to where faults could rupture on the surface of the globe, and perhaps, you know, what is the probability given certain amount of knowledge about the velocity, about the convergence rate, or the movement between different plates, could we have predicted the Sumatra rupture? Could we have predicted its extent? Could we have predicted its rupture details? This is the Pacific region, And the red patches are those patches where earthquakes have not taken place. This map is about 30 years old. So it was drawn at the time showing all those patches where earthquakes had not ruptured the boundary, like this over here, there, for at least 100 years. And they labeled these regions as regions of high expected seismicity. Some of these have since been broken. This, as you can see, is clearly marked as red as could be. And therefore, it's no surprise that the Sumatra earthquake happened here. In fact, many people had believed, they held the view that this has already had accumulated a large amount of slip, which would be released in the very near future. A certain geologist by the name of Kerry C., who works at Caltech, for example, he had even looked at the sediments in this region and found evidences of some recent movements and warned. But of course, warnings of geologists don't always, partly because their conclusions are not always quantitative, they don't attract that much. So it was not an unexpected region where this faulting took place. What was unexpected was that it should have broken 500 kilometers long segment in one go, and then stopped for about a minute or so, and continued it for another 700 kilometers. So from there to there, about 12 to 1300 kilometers of the plate boundary segment. We can see that this is the plate boundary. And as I said, most of these stresses accumulate at the plate boundaries. And in this case, these stresses are in that direction. So this is, the locale is not surprising. What is surprising is that it should have taken place in such a long leap, linking up the fracture systems in one big go. And that's one big lesson we learned today, not to exclude the possibility that rupture zones can link up sometime to form a very long zone. And remember, the energy is length times the width times the slip, and that multiplied with the coefficient of friction. And there's a scaling law which will of course determine as to how the width will be controlled by the length and the slip. So if there's a long length, then the slip is going to be longer too. So when you combine all this knowledge and give and include the possibility that long ruptures could take place, then of course we have to reassess our methods of assessing hazard. What we could not recognize was that such a long thing will take place, and we were particularly discouraged in making that assumption, because two earthquakes had taken place here in 1941 and 1881 earthquake, the pre-seismic instrument earthquake about which I have already talked about. And therefore, it was assumed that these would have released these stresses already. This would be a low strain area. But apparently, when this rupture broke, it even went through the low strain area right up to there. So that was a great surprise. And now we are beginning to understand as to why that happened from the seismic analysis, from the analysis of seismic records that have been coming since. This is what we knew. We knew that that's the kind of seismicity. Between 1900 and 2002, all the magnitude 6 earthquakes are plotted here, and you can see the locus. You can also see the locus here, about which I shall not say more, except that this whole plate, which in the other map was seen as one, is now seen to be divided. This is the Indian plate, and the Australian plate apparently have relative motion too. And because of the resistance being offered to the Himalayas, these forces are tending to create a new fracture system. This is a new plate boundary in the making. That's only about 400 kilometers from the Indian shores, and perhaps it won't happen for another million years, but if it was there, then that would be another possible source. So we knew this 7.7 in 1941. Unfortunately, there are very few records here, because that was the time when the islands were briefly occupied by the Japanese. This is the one whose rupture had been modeled from the tight gauge data which the British had set up around the Bay of Bengal a few years earlier. And this is the March 28 earthquake, because that earthquake having ripped over there is still at its edge over here. It piled up a lot of stresses, or at least raised the stress level here by a couple of bars. And this is what those scientists in Scotland calculated, and they wrote a paper in Nature a few weeks before this earthquake took place. They wrote a paper in Nature saying that they see, calculating the and using the physical formulation which is already known of elastic deformation and fracture, that the stresses here had exceeded 2 or 3 bars, and that could be enough to trigger this. And sure enough, this happened. And apparently, there is a prediction that it might further go over that side. Now, tsunami was created by this. It also depends on how fast the things move. If we very slowly lift the water column, then it's not going to create tsunami. And the tsunami generated by the Sumatra earthquake was generated by just the first 500 kilometer segment, not all the 1300 kilometer segment. In fact, there was imperceptible tsunami caused by the rupture of this part, which went through this low strain zone. And if these earthquakes had not taken place, it was not a low strain zone, and the whole thing would have ripped, then I think the entire East Coast would have been devastated. But fortunately, that didn't happen, because the rupture zone number, firstly, it was partitioned, and secondly, the process here was much slower, and there was much less uplift of the ocean floor over here. So this again, the same, this is a seismogram from the Indiana University Seismic Center, and there are many such seismograms around the world. I just picked this one because it shows that there are several P phases, and they attest to the fact, you know, that the plate is tearing, and as it tears, it's like a source which is propagating along the fracture zone. It doesn't instantaneously do that, because the crack procedure is something where communication between neighboring elements is involved, and that can only take place at the maximum speed of the shear wave speed, which is about 3 kilometers. So about 3 kilometers is the limiting. This happened at about 2.5. So let's say 2.5, 1,200 kilometers will take something like 600. So it took about 10 minutes to propagate. But what we are learning from the fine structure of these seismograms is the complexity of this rupture mechanism. What is plotted here is the slip. What you see here are the contour of this. This is depth, which says that we are from about 10 to 40 kilometers. And minus 50, so it's a 400 kilometer long segment. And the slip, this is the value of, these are the contours of the slip. And you can see how heterogeneous it is. The slip is maximum here, and then it decreases. This is the, you can see it's almost zero towards the end here. And maximum over here, somewhere in the middle. This is the Bhuj earthquake, which I've plotted here just to show the comparison between the area. The seismic moment here was about so much, and the seismic moment over here is 2 orders of magnitude larger. This kind of a knowledge is something which comes rarely, because such large earthquakes involving such large rupture planes, where complex processes would be at work, are very rare. So this is what we are beginning to learn, and this will go towards enriching the ensemble of ruptures that one might assume in fracture zones to create hazard maps. So to that extent, this is new learning. This is another piece of evidence that comes from the aftershock studies. And you can see that this is where the rupture is started, around latitude 3, this main shock. And that's around the northern end of Andamans. Over here, the aftershock magnitude, they started late. You can see it over here. And these also tell their story of how the rupture proceeded. As I said, that the locale of the Sumatra earthquake was not a surprise. And we always had felt, you know, that we should know as to what is the kinematics, what is the rate at which deformation is taking place. So about 6 or 7 years ago, CMAC scientists went and made some measurements in Port Blair, repeated it for about 2 or 3 years, and they came to a figure of convergence with respect to Bangalore along that line of 14 millimeters per year. Now 14 millimeters translated into 100, that's 1.4 centimeter, translated over 2 centuries will become something like 3 meters. And that's the kind of slip which, when available, is ready to fracture a system. So one was conscious of this, and last year, in 2003 end, we again occupied about 4 points, which we remeasured after the earthquake. And this is going to appear in the next issue of Current Science. These are the velocities measured at so many other places by CMAC scientists to work out the strain field in the region between the foothills of the Himalayas and Cape Comorin, and particularly in this region where the strain field is much higher, because we have something like 3 millimeters per year of compression, which is within the observational error, between Delhi and Kanyakumari, but 20 millimeters in this 100 kilometer zone. So you can imagine that we already have something like, but I shan't talk about the implication to the Himalayas. These are the results of the measurements that I just alluded to, and I'm essentially trying to say as to what is it that we are learning. This is what we model, that kind of a slip, and that will explain the results that I've just shown you. This is another schematic model to show you as to what was happening before the earthquake. This was slipping, ductile slip, not causing any earthquake, but you can see as to what it is doing to the strain field in this region. And then that's the continental part of it. This is Port Blair in this model. And what happened after the slip, because when that was slipping, it was stretching this part. But this part was locked by friction. So as you see, this part which was locked by friction has been unlocked, and this become one slip boundary. But of course, this will not release any, this part won't release any energy, because that's already slipped. The slip deficit was only in here, which will release energy. And this is the way the islands are redistributed. And that is what we see in our GPS results. So this tells us to how the entire island topography has changed, and we would need to re-establish the new databases which have been reset, and hopefully Survey of India will do that job. And of course, the same holds good for the hydrography of the Andaman Ocean, which is a very critical thing, and it is in the very high resolution imaging of that zone and its actual surface topography that can tell us a great deal of how things will happen in this region. Yeah, I show this here only to point out that this is the Sunda Trench, and this entire thing is a plate boundary. The 28th March earthquake happened here. I've already talked about it. And this is the 1833 earthquake, broke this part. The 28th March broke this part, and that's liable to go, because you can see that it has. So don't be surprised if you find that this has further progressed over there, because the whole boundary is being stressed, and those energies have to be released someday or the other. This is the 28th March earthquake, and it's now the concerns ahead. What are the possible tsunami genetic sources around the Indian Ocean, tectonic and others? What is the chronology of tsunami generation in the Bay of Bengal? The chronology now becomes important, because we find that there is very little from this limited data to guide us about the actual rupture mechanism. And it turns out rupture mechanism is so important. If it was one full rupture from one end to the other, one can't imagine as to what would have happened on the entire eastern coast. But it didn't go that way. What was responsible for it? I think if we can put some handle on what kind of tsunamis were generated at what times, date them, because our historical record is very poor, we'll greatly enrich our understanding of how the stress accumulation and release in the region works in time and space. We have to realize, in answering that question, concerns ahead, that the basic power which creates all the seismicities in the Himalayas and around it is provided by the movement of the Indian plate, which has plowed its way as far south under Tibet, because Tibet is behaving more like a viscous material, as far north as Lhasa. And this we have seen. One of my students just written his PhD thesis at the University of Cambridge, and he's seen the signature of the Indian plate underneath Lhasa at a depth of something like 80 kilometers. Scientists of NGRI are seeing the same in Ladakh, Himalaya, right up to Pamir. They see this. Now, it's a wonderful problem for fluid dynamicists to handle. Some people in Cambridge are working for it. I'll talk to you, Rodham, about it and possibility of collaborating. So, if that's the basic, that's what provides the basic motive force. These are the regions where these stresses are building. This is the region along which, or this is the fault or the rupture plane along which India is slipping past the Arabian Peninsula. But Arabian Peninsula itself is heading towards this landmass, Afghanistan and Iran and all that, creating a subduction zone, that means the ocean going down a continental region along this Makran coast. So what is this seismogenetic source? One is, of course, here. I doubt if for the next 100 years you will have any significant tsunami generated in this region, because the 1941, 1881, and the new earthquake apparently has ruptured all the slip that had accumulated there. It would take a long time, depending based on the relative velocities over here that I've just talked about, for that amount of energy again to be accumulated. So I do not think that there will be a significant event here. But there was a 1945 earthquake over here, which only partly, now we know, going back to the records, they didn't fracture the entire boundary right up to ductile layer. It only partly did so. This was 1945, 60 years ago. And therefore, over the next 50 years, and when that happened, it destroyed the town of Pasni in Pakistan, raised tsunamis to a height of several meters in Karachi and Kutch, and was felt as far south as Karwar, 1600 kilometers away. Today, that the scale of our development projects are so heavily concentrated over here, even a low intensity tsunami could cause tremendous hazard. And that is something we need to be aware of if we think of what are the future threats against which we must safeguard. There was also a tsunami apparently reported in 1524, 2 years before the Mughals came to India, in Goa. And the question to ask is, what caused that tsunami? I think we need to answer all these questions in order to get a handle on what are the different sources that create tsunamis and what were their recurrence periods. That was the boundary I was talking about. This is a 1945 tsunami, which was caused by this. Those were the 41 and 1881. And this is another source of tsunami, another possible source of tsunami, slumping of mudslides on the continental slopes. And these have been known not to generate inconsiderable tsunamis in some part of the world. Was the 1524 tsunami in Goa caused by this? And of course, by looking at the sediments, which are often lodged in some earth archive, which can be excavated and examined, one can say as to whether this is tsunami sediment or it is a slump sediment. And of course, one can date it, hopefully, in some way. So those are the kind of researches we have to engage in. Another source of tsunami is volcanoes. And here is the Krakatoa volcano. That was the pre-eruption period in 1883. And this is, you see what had happened to this caldera over here. And this raised tsunamis. This is located here between Sumatra and Java. That raised tsunami of something like of the order of a little less than a meter on the Madras coast. Hazard maps by assuming ensemble of possible rupture zones and modeling tsunami effects on them. Education and awareness. I believe you know that is the most effective alert or warning system that we can have. So that if a child knows that the sea has suddenly receded by several kilometers and that it's bound to return, even though it will take some time, you know, because these waves have a long period, something like 30 minutes or even more. Then, of course, and this has happened, it's been reported also in the news, how children who have this kind of a knowledge in the Western world, because it's a part of their general knowledge and information, can be of so much help. So education and awareness, I believe, and given all those societally involved problems that Dr. Ramamurthy mentioned, which will remain with us forever, as natural hazards will remain with us forever. I think this is our greatest resource. And we must not underestimate it simply because it may remain intangible. I think that's something which we must do. Hotels on the shores, for example, should carry notices. They should tell people what to do at what times. Maybe that there should be some posts on the seashore to do that. Then we need to put systems. Dr. Ramamurthy has already talked about it. We need to create data inventories about bathymetry, about microgravity networks. One can think of a great deal, and of course, communication software. This is not a trivial thing. This is a product, you know, which has to be designed. It has to be designed in the sense that what will create the impact on the mind of the person? We can say a lot of things, but unless we put it pictorially or in words in the proper way, the impact will not be high. So it's a highly professional kind of job to create communication software. And I think that we should invest sufficient energy on that. Then, of course, research. I have mentioned some of these, so I'll pass over. This is just to show from the Shuttle Radar Topographic Mission, which was run by the United States, a lot of topography of the Earth. And Dr. Rangan, if I might mention, they have these images of the Indian subcontinent also at 30-meter resolution. It won't be, but that's not public. At 90-meter resolution, I can download it, although I'm told by some American friends that they are going to classify this. But the 30-meter resolution can probably be obtained on government-to-government basis. A knowledge of topography is something which is so crucial to virtually everything that we do, that if we can get those 30-meter maps, I just thought of it, but here I just paused to show you this particular island over here, which in the next slide will show, has terraces. That's 10 meters, 20 meters, 30 meters, and these were apparently formed by repeated uplifts. We can date these by the corals that they have and other materials. The corals have isotopes which can tell us rather precisely as to when these things happen, and they could add and enrich our knowledge about past tsunamis and past uplifts of this coastal region. What one does? Well, in the wake of this, for example, many organizations, Trivandrum says, then this is the, there are some Hyderabad, NGRI Hyderabad, and some other, and CMAX, we have established a large number of these GPS stations, which will hopefully be measured and will continue to be measured over the next couple of years so that we have a better handle on the strain field, the deformation field, and then modeling the subsurface slip plane, the strain field. We could probably have something like this. As Professor Nasima said, we have at our command all the physics of the fluids. We can generate some anticipations of what the rupture could be. And we could start this kind of a modeling over a large scale and also gear ourselves to assimilate in our modeling real-time data that can come from satellites, like this, for example. And I have shown earlier pictures of that. These are some of the things to do. This is another thing. To ask oneself, Chennai coast is well known, we know its topography, or can be mapped even more. What will happen if 1 meter rise takes place? What will the incursion be? You can see these incursions. And 3 meters, 5, 7, 9. This could become a very evocative way of classifying the shorelines as to where we should build, where we should, if we need to build, we should build only on stilts and make them strong enough. And where, for example, if we have critical facilities like Kalapakkam, this tsunami barrier in Japan, which tells you that in limited areas, you can't make a whole dike as someone suggested around the coast, but limited areas, of course, one could do this. Or one could have alert systems. And this is just a conceptual design which I've been trying to sell, is that if an earthquake takes place and you have large collection of seismograms, then in the vicinity of the earthquake, the nearest seismogram will give you virtually the input function of the waves that proceed from there and arrive at some other place, depending on the Green's function. And these Green's functions are time invariant. So making use of the small earthquake or small events, it will hold good further. One can work out the Green's function, use this, keep this large library of Green's function at your disposal, which computers can retrieve at the press of a button. And if an earthquake in the Himalaya, for example, takes place, then within maybe about 20 seconds, you can generate as to what the ground motion would be in different parts of Delhi and communicate it using wireless long before, not long, 40 seconds, 50 seconds before the killer waves arrive. Because the earthquake killer waves are also slower than the body waves that come. Now, this would be good to shut off things like large utilities, you know, power and various other things, which have a cascade effect in generating damage. We have this about which Dr. Kasturi Rangan must be familiar, Charter for Disasters, where you know, this international system. You start here, if something has happened, like a tsunami has happened, and then you go around and somebody will query what are the space satellites in the air. They will collect data, and by the combined effort of all the satellites that there are, they will generate the information and will come back to you. So it was, I understand, it was signed when you were the chairman. And we have this system going. This system has worked in bomb, in the earthquake took place in Iran. They were able to get, and you know the enormous advantages of such a system. Even if a damage has taken place, if you get a picture of the damaged area within hours, half a day, then you can direct your rescue and relief teams much more effectively, instead of all of them, you know, jamming each other's activities. So you can see how high technology, that's just my concept of what kind of an administration. I wanted to say that the Earth is like a cosmic poem. That's how I feel about it. Because it's the most spectacular object in space, distinguished by the various hues reflected by its deserts, its ice fields, its clouds, its green fields, and shafts of sunlight from the ocean. And we are adding the fifth very significant subsystem to this, and that's our designed world. We can hopefully save it from being threatened by the designed world and retain its splendor by adding greater design in our minds, in our works, in our educational systems, in our administrative management systems, on the drawing boards, and in execution. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gao, for your very comprehensive account of seismology and tsunamis. I think you set the right tone for the subsequent discussions in this meeting. We are really running out of time, actually. In fact, we are already half an hour delayed. So maybe there is scope for just one or two clarifications, because still I don't want to have this lecture concluded. There is a discussion. Maybe we can then postpone it. Maybe one question we can still allow, just one question, if anybody has got. Okay, thank you. I think we will keep it for the discussion session. I think then the next one,
in magnitude earthquake, very close to an ocean bottom, but without disturbing the ocean bottom, you won't have a tsunami. Because the waves may be large, you may have 5 centimeters of displacement, but that's not enough to couple the...
The reason why I asked is that, there's going to be a presentation also on this animals sensing the tsunami. Now, we are all aware of the animal sensing earthquakes, possibly because of the vibrations which the earthquake set in.
I don't know.
What about tsunami? How do they get the signal regarding the approaching tsunami? Is there any other medium through which the animal sense it?
Weather, atmospheric pressure. I mean, there are so many
other parameters.
It's very hard to say as to what is actually setting off this.
Okay. Thank you.
Sixth sense.
Okay. What am I supposed to do?